Okay. My question is, do you know or are you aware of looking at x-rays and then classifying the cuff tear and grading it by just looking at an x-ray?
No, sir.
Okay. It's called the Hamada classification, H-A-M-A-D-A.
Okay.
It's got various grades. The first grade is the distance between the acromion and the top of the humerus is less than 10 millimeters, but more 10 centimeters, but more than 5. Yeah. Grade 2 is when you have less than 5 centimeters. If you look at grade 3, then scalloping. Okay. Grade 4 is scalloping with arthritis, and grade 5 is scalloping with arthritis and destruction of joint, and grade 6 is destruction of the joint.
So okay, sir.
We need to know these classification is to decide whether this patient can have a cuff repair or not. If you have arthritis, i.e. if you've gone to grade 4, then you can't have anything done soft tissue, as you have to have bony joint. Okay, so looking at this x-ray now, how are you going to confirm that this patient has a cuff tear?
Sir, after taking a brief history, first of all, and then doing the examination of the specific left shoulder joint.
Okay, so what examination can you do to assess cuff tears?
Sir, in examination, I will do for, first of all, I will check the active and the passive range of motion.
Okay, but that's not specific, that is general, isn't it?
On examination, first of all, I see, I fully expose the patient. First, I inspect the patient from front
to the lateral. Okay, listen, in the exam, there is very limited time to explain. You can't say everything. So my question was, what are the specific tests for cuff tear? Examine the patient for a shoulder.
Sir, one is the job test.
Okay, so what's the job test?
Job test is abduct the shoulder, abduct the arm.
Okay, so what are you looking for in the job test?
Sir, looking for the supraspinatus tendon tear.
It's a very, very unusual test to do for supraspinatus so early on, but supraspinatus stress test is the easiest one, isn't it, to start with?
Okay.
So what's a supraspinatus stress test?
Sir, abduct the shoulder at 90 degrees in the frontal plane, and then thumbs is downward, and then ask the patient to resist lift the
Listen, Dr. Munawar's question first. What he used to see, he is asking for supraspinatus stress test, and you are telling the job in empty can and full can. So first, listen the question.
Okay.
That's correct. So you want to see if the supraspinatus is present, and if it's present, is it powerful enough or not? Okay, so you are going to look at the back of the shoulder while the patient is in front of you, and you will try to resist, or he will try to lift his shoulder in the plane of the scapula, and if you can, then the supraspinatus is functioning. Then you stop resisting it, or you resist it, and if it's not working or it's weak, then that is weak cuff. Okay, so that is the test you have to do. For infraspinatus anterior minor, what will you do? What test do you know of that?
For infraspinatus, there is an external rotation leg test.
No. So you have to ask the patient to externally rotate. Okay. And if the patient cannot externally rotate, then either the infraspinatus or teres minor is not working. If you can rotate but cannot do it under resistance, then again, the infraspinatus and teres minor is not working. If the patient can externally rotate in adduction, then both muscles are working. Okay, so you will ask the person first to externally rotate. I will show you pictures later on, yeah? If you externally rotate under resistance and it's weak, then you want to find out if it's the infraspinatus or the teres minor. So infraspinatus is the extension rotation lag sign, i.e. external rotation in abduction. The teres minor is the Hornblower sign, which is abduction and internal rotation. So the difference between both of them is they're in abduction. Internal rotation is teres minor, external rotation is infraspinatus. Okay, so you will ask them to elevate their hand against resistance in the plane of the scapula with the thumb pointing down, and if it's not working, supraspinatus is gone. If the extension rotation lag sign and Hornblower's is present, then one of the infraspinatus is mine. What is the test for subscap?
Sir, belly press test.
Good. There are three tests, but belly test is not the one everybody does. But yes, okay. Tell me the belly test.
Sir, ask the patient to press his on the ask the, to press the belly, and then if he and then external rotate against the resistant. If the subscapularis tendon is tear, then he is having a pain.
Okay, so you must understand what anatomy you're looking for. Okay, so in this, what you're looking for is internal rotation. But in abduction, so if the patient is asked to push the belly in internal rotation and the shoulders in abduction, because of the subscap, there will be no abduction. The person's elbow will fall, i.e. he will not be able to maintain abduction while trying to internally rotate. Okay. It's anatomical. You need to know, understand the test. If you don't know anatomically understanding the test, then by naming the test is not good enough. Okay. So what is the commonest tendon that tears?
It's a surprise. Spinatus is the most common tendon.
Very good. Okay. So in the exam, please don't say, sir, sir, this, because you have to show that you're a consultant and you're confident. Okay. So what you need to say is the supraspinatus is the most commonest tendon that's torn. Okay. Just leave it at that. Yeah. Okay. So how will you assess a supraspinatus tendon?
You earlier mentioned that
a clinical test
and then ultrasound.
Very good. So the ultrasound is the best mode of assessing a cuff tears, yeah? So I do them in my own office because I have my own, but you have to have a good sonographer that you can trust that can tell you that the supraspinatus is torn, okay? So once somebody's told you that the supraspinatus is torn, what's the next thing to do?
We'll go for the MRI.
What for?
MRI for the cuff tears, for looking the cuff tears.
But the ultrasound has just shown you the cuff tear.
So, sir, we will grade on MRI, we will grade the tear. What is the size of the tear?
The ultrasound will also tell you the size of the tear. The MRI scan will tell you whether the tendon is repairable or not, i.e. it will tell you fatty infiltration, and it will also tell you how much of it is in the scapula, okay? So when you do an ultrasound, the ultrasound will show you this. The ultrasound will show you where the tear is, i.e. whether it's in the front, at the top, or at the back. So whether the supraspinatus is gone, the infraspinatus teres minor is gone, or the subscap's gone. Once you've done that, the ultrasound will also tell you that it's a small, medium, large, or a massive tear. So if it's less than centimeter, more, less than 3 centimeters, less than 5 centimeters, or more than 5 centimeters. What is the difference between these four tears?
On the basis of this measurement, we will decide whether we have to repair, it is repairable or not repairable.
Good. So if it is more than 5 centimeters, it becomes a massive tear and it is not repairable. Well, you can repair it, but why do you not repair tears above 5 centimeters? Is there a reason?
No, sir, I don't.
Yeah, so the reason is that the evidence suggests that size matters. So it doesn't matter how old you are, or how long the tear is, but if it is longer, if it is bigger than 5 centimeters, then there is an 80% chance that this will fail within the first year. So if you have evidence that this is going to fail, there's no point in repairing a tear which is bigger than 5 centimeters, okay? So you can repair it, but it won't stay. So it is now by definition a irreparable tear, okay? And this is why you do an MRI scan, okay? The MRI scan is done to look at the shape of the scapula and a vi. Do you know what classification this is? It's the Gottlieb's classification, isn't it? It tells you whether the supraspinatus and the infraspinatus is bulky, acceptable, shrinking, or atrophied. So if you repair this tendon and this tendon, the outcome will be very good. But if you try to repair this one and this one, the outcome will be very poor. So this classification, again, tells you the outcome and how big the tear is and do you want to repair it or not, okay? So now we know from our clinical assessment that the cuff is torn. We have done an ultrasound which shows that it is less than 5 centimeters tear, and we have done an MRI scan which shows no fatty infiltration and it is a type 2. Okay, so what are you going to do for those tears? You will obviously repair them, isn't it? Because I've just told you that it is less than 5 centimeters and it's a good quality tendon. So do you know any method of repairing cuff tears?
Sir, There is a tendon transfer technique.
Okay, so before you tendon transfer, we've just talked about repairs. So repair means we repair it completely, isn't it?
It's arthroscopic repair.
Either open or arthroscopic, okay, depending on your specialty or whether you can do it or you can't do it, okay? So if you are doing an arthroscopic and open repair, what is the one term that the examiners want to hear, the ones you want to use? This is what type of repair? So do you understand anything about the double row repair?
No, sir.
Okay, so you have to repair the tendon in a double row. You know, when you repair tendons in the fingers, how do you repair a tendon in the finger?
By direct suturing or Bunnell technique and multiple other techniques.
You have two sutures you use. One is the core suture, which gives you
strength.
One is a running suture, which makes the tendon smooth. Agreed?
Okay.
Yeah, so core suture and a running suture. So the same is for supraspinatus. Because of the tendon, you have to have a suture that gives it strength. Okay, so the core suture is the mattress suture, which gives it strength. And then you have a running suture, which puts the footprint down on the bone to allow it to heal. This is called a double row repair, or it is called transosseous equivalent. You're trying to put the sutures or the tendon onto bone so it can heal. You cannot have a tendon heal unless it goes into bone, isn't it? You agree that?
Okay, sir.
These are all basic principles, okay? I've not even gone into cuff repairs. I'm just asking you basic principles. So remember, when you're repairing a tendon, it has to have a core suture for strength and a running suture. Every time you repair a finger tendon, that's what you do, isn't it? You put a core suture to bring it together and a stitch from outside to smoothen it, isn't it?
Yes,
okay. So let's revise again. So in a cuff tear, first of all, is you will do a plain film x-ray. Okay, let's go back again. You'll do a plain film x-ray, and on this x-ray, it shows that the cuff's gone. We think it's gone because it's scalloping this acromion, right? And we think there is no arthritis in here, so we think this is a Hamada 3, okay? Yes. So because it's a cuff tear, we now need to know whether we can repair it or not. So we've clinically assessed and confirmed that the supraspinatus is gone, the subscap infraspinatus teres minor is okay. By the way, what is the function of the supraspinatus?
So abduction, initiation of the abduction of the shoulder.
So where did you read that?
I recall from my memory.
Okay. So do you think God has given you a major tendon such as the supraspinatus, all to do is initiate abduction?
No.
So the answer is in the question. The answer is no.
Bajine.
No.
Maladas Siddhi Kasam de Paimandu.
Okay. So basically, when you look at evidence, they have done a nerve conduction electromyographic studies on the supraspinatus. Every time the shoulder moves, the supraspinatus is active.
Okay.
So the function of the supraspinatus is to push the humerus back into the socket to allow it to stabilize the joint so that the rest of the muscles can work.
Okay, then.
So you cannot have any function unless the supraspinatus is pushing the ball back into the socket.
Okay, sir.
Right. So if you go back to your assessment, history taking examination, every time somebody has a supraspinatus tear, nothing else, just a supraspinatus tear, what happens to their shoulder?
Unable to abduct full.
He is unable to move his shoulder at all. He cannot do anything.
Yeah.
Yes. So if this was an abductor initiator, you think that everything other function would not work? It will work, isn't it? So the job of the supraspinatus, you must understand this very clearly. The job of the supraspinatus is to put the
humerus back down
so all the other muscles can work. Okay. It's a restrainer, or it stops the shoulder from going up.
Okay.
So you will assess the supraspinatus, and then what you do is you ultrasound then to see where the tear is. So you classify the tear by it's a front tear, superior tear, or a posterior tear. Okay, and then you will classify by finding out how big it is. Then you will not need to know whether it's repairable or irreparable. Okay, the reason big tears don't do well is there is evidence to support that 80% of them fail in the first year. Okay, and then. And then you need to classify them with the MRI scan to see whether it is repairable or not. When you have decided that it is a repairable tendon, i.e. it is less than 5 centimeters, and on the MRI scan it shows a filling of the notch and the quality is very good and there's no fatty infiltration or atrophy of the muscle, then you will repair them. You can repair them open or arthroscopic, okay? And if you open or arthroscopic repair them, the principle is the same. You have to do a double row repair. You have to do a double row repair. One is the core suture and one is the strength. When is the running suture?
Running suture. Okay, sir.
Yeah, and the answer to that is called a transosseous equivalent suture. Okay, because in the old days, you had to make holes in the humerus and pull the tendon down onto it. However, in this case, you cannot put holes into the humerus because it's arthroscopically opening. We don't do this, so we call it a transosseous equivalent sutures, okay? So we used to call them transosseous repair. Now we call it transosseous equivalent, or the simple thing is a double row repair. Happy?
Okay, sir.
Okay, so before we move on, I want you guys to have this concept clear. So ask me a question now before we move on. Any questions, anything that is not clear in your minds?
I daily came across with multiple shoulder joint pain. So how can I can differentiate that on initial examination? Is there is a subacromial impingement or patient is having supraspinatus?
That's a very good question. So the thing is, you know, do you play sport? Do you play games like PS4 and Xbox and all that kind of stuff? They have cheat codes. If you put in that cheat codes, you can do things that you can't do normally, okay? So the cheat code is, first of all, is age. If you're below the age of 40, then you cannot have a cuff tear.
Okay.
Okay? So if you're above the age of 40, then you can have a cuff tear and impingement. All right.
Okay.
And now you need to know which one. So you can clinically assess them, and the impingement is tested by what is called a Near's test. Do you know what a Near's test is?
Yes, sir. Near's impingement test, in which we have to inject a local xylocaine. If the pain is subside after giving that, then this is the impingement test.
Okay, so the impingement test is the nearest test. The injection will tell you that the person has got features of impingement. Plus, if you look at the x-rays, it will tell you what type of acromion you have. Do you know the types of acromion?
Curve acromion. There's a three type, I think. Curve acromion, hook acromion, hook type, another one type. I can't recall. There's a three type, hook.
Curve, beak, and hook.
So there is a lot of disturbance. I can't hear you.
No, it's not. It's very straightforward. Flat, curved, and hooked. Okay?
Yes, sir.
So if you have a flat acromion, you will never have problems all your life unless you start taking steroids and building a muscle and you have a fat muscle from inside, then that's a problem. In a curved one, by the time you're 40, you will have problems. And the reason for that is that there is wear and tear going on and repair going on at the same time. However, up to the 40 age, you have got good enough supply, so when you go to sleep, it will repair your tendon, and in the morning, you will have fresh, nice tendon doing the same thing again. But if you have a hook tendon, by the time you're 20, it'll tear you. Okay? So you need to know from looking at the x-rays at the acromion that what type it is, type 1, type 2, and type 3. An impingement does not mean a tear, and a tear does not mean you have impingement. Do you understand that concept?
Yes, sir.
So if you have a tear, it could be an injury from activity rather than acromion. However, it's more common with impingement. Okay, and you must also understand that everybody who's got a cuff tear does not end up in a cuff tear arthropathy.
Yes.
Okay, what's a cuff tear arthropathy?
Sir, if there is a if the cuff tear lead to the joint destruction or arthritis or arthritis of the glenohumeral joint, then it is called cuff arthropathy.
No, it's called Milwaukee shoulder. You have to have crystals. And you have to have cyst formation and massive destruction and fluid connection. That's called cuff tear arthropathy. Yes. Okay, that's why I said a cuff tear will lead to arthritis, but a cuff tear will not lead to cuff tear arthropathy.
Okay,
so we clear all this now?
Okay, sir.
Okay, it's a difficult topic, but once you know the concept, it's very easy to go through because a lot of people don't read shoulders purely because nobody teaches shoulders. And therefore, in the exam, the examiners will pick a shoulder topic, and you don't know it, then you won't leave it, like I said. So you need to be 100% on your concept of cuff tears. Okay? You need to diagnose it. You need to know whether you can repair it or not. What if you can't repair it? What will you do?
Sir, if it is irreparable or we can't repair the tendon, then we can go for the transfer.
Very good. So one of the options is tendon transfers. Okay, you can take a tendon and replace it to give function for function. So if you have a supraspinatus tear, which tendon do you normally transfer?
Lat dorsi or pectoralis major.
So pectoralis major is only for subscap tears. Okay. It is not big enough or long enough for you to turn it around to replace the supraspinatus. So for pec major is only for subscap tears. Okay, but lat dorsi is the workhorse for doing a supraspinatus work, yeah?
Okay, sir.
So if you don't have the capabilities or the skill to do a lat dorsi tear, what other options are available?
Sir, there is another synthetic graft reconstruction, allograft, synthetic graft.
So you can do what is called a pantaloon or a graft onto the shoulder to repair the cuff, yeah?
Yes.
So what do people like me do who are shoulder specialists? What do they do? I mean, I don't know how to do lat dorsi. Well, I do, but I don't do many lat dorsi transfers. And I don't like doing a pantaloon graft, a synthetic graft, because it doesn't take very often. So what are my choices?
Probably your choice is synthetic graft.
So what we do is called the Himada classification. Remember, we did the Himada classification. That is why I need to know where there's no arthritis. So most of my patients who are 40s or less than 40, they have a massive irreparable cuff. I can't do a joint replacement with them, so I have to do something else. I could do a lat dorsi transfer, but that's very difficult. It takes a long time. For me, okay, I do what is called three procedures. One of them is called a balloon insertion. The second one is superior capsular reconstruction. And the third one is called bar procedure, which is called bursal acromion replacement. Okay. So in a balloon procedure, if the patient has got minimal pain on passive range of motion, it mechanically pushes the ball back into the socket. So I arthroscopically put a balloon into the joint, which puts the humeral down just like a supraspinatus, and the deltoid then works. Okay.
Okay, sir.
So that's one of my options. The second option is if the pain is too much, then I do what is called superior capsular reconstruction. So we take a dermal graft. It's a human or animal dermal graft, and I replace the cuff by putting anchors on the glenoid and the supraspinatus side of the humeral head. So what it does is it suppresses again the humeral head, and therefore it stops the pain, and the function is done by deltoid. And my third option is when patient is very old and I just want to do a palliative surgery, I will take the graft and hook it under the acromion so it increases space. So these are patients who are arthritic but not fit to have surgery. I will do what is called a bursal acromion resurfacing. But for the exact purposes, you must understand irreparable cuff in young people. You will do a lat dorsi transfer. Okay.
Okay.
Okay. So are we clear on cuffs now completely?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, we'll do this. There's plenty of time for the exams. We'll go ahead and again. So every Sunday, I will give you an hour and a half until the exam. So by the time you go to the exam, everything will be clear. Okay. Okay, so this is the key concept of the supraspinatus. The ball is not in the socket, right? Because of supraspinatus, the ball's in the socket. So you have to put the ball back into the socket. And by putting the ball back into the socket, the deltoid then works. That's how the reverse works. The deltoid is functioning and the ball is in the socket, okay? So these are the principles we just talked about. Okay, so we have a cuff and it doesn't work. So the ball's gone too high. So you can do a repair, which is called transosseous equivalent repair or a double row repair. See that, that's a mattress suture that is putting the core suture and the strength suture, and these are the lateral sutures which bring the tendon down onto the bone. So you have to have a double row repair for cuff repairs, okay? You can do a cuff repair. If you have a cuff that doesn't work, you can put a reverse shoulder into it. And the reverse shoulder can only be done in 65 years or above, or rheumatoid patients. If you can't do that, then you put a balloon in it, or you can put a synthetic graft in it, or you can put a dermal graft in it, and this is called interposition arthroplasty, yeah?
Okay? Okay, sir.
And this is what the graft look like. This is what the superior capsular reconstructions look like. That's a superior capsular reconstruction. This is a dermal patch, and this is a balloon.
Okay, sir.
So we are now complete on cuff repairs, yeah?
Yes, sir.
Okay, so who's going to go next? Who's done next? We're learning. I mean, I don't make fun of anybody and I don't shout or scream at you, so you must speak.
Sir, again,
if you don't speak in the exam, you will find it very difficult.
Sir, shall I go again?
No. I want somebody else to have a go. There's a 10 or 11 or 12 of us. You need to participate, guys. I mean, you have to talk before the exam. You have to talk.
Sir, it's help in memorizing the thing.
I know, yes, but other people have to do it. Other people have to do it.
Sir, may I?
Yeah, of course. What's your name? Sorry.
So my name is Salman.
Okay, fine. So look at this X-ray and describe this.
Sir, I want to say before this, I have a really bad connection. Keep on, disconnecting, reconnecting.
Okay, so we'll wait with you. At the moment, we can hear you, so you can tell us what you see.
Okay, so this is a X-ray. This is a plain radiograph of a skeletal mature patient, which I can appreciate. Assuming this is the left shoulder joint. My findings in this X-ray, I can see there is a partial superior migration of the humeral head and also calcification near the greater tuberosity.
Okay. In the exam, there is money for diagnosis. There is no money for confabulation. Do you know what confabulation is?
No, sir.
Talking around the stuff but not telling me the real thing.
Okay.
So it's a time-limited exam. And if you keep saying things that don't score you points, then you may be talking, but you're not gaining any points, okay? So if I was you and this was shown to me, I would say, this is an X-ray of a skeletally mature shoulder showing calcific tendonitis. And that's it. I've done the X-ray. I've given you, it's an adult, and I've told you the diagnosis.
Right, sir.
Okay, because even a first-year medical student would tell you that this is a shoulder, there's an acromion and all that kind of stuff. So here you are going to be a consultant. You will be seeing patients in clinic and you will be making diagnosis. And this is how you need to be in the exam. So you can say this is a skeletally mature left shoulder, which is showing calcific tendonitis. Okay. So then I will ask you, what is calcific tendonitis? Can you tell me what is calcific tendonitis?
Sir, this is the heterotrophic calcification of the insertion of the supraspinatus tendon.
Okay.
It is caused by repetitive micro trauma.
Good.
And
so how does it present?
Sir, it presents limitation in motion and also a painful limited motion.
So it is one of the most painful condition you will see in A&E. The patient will come to you with a completely painful shoulder. He will be in tears and he will tell you like somebody stabbing his shoulder. This is the most painful condition you will ever see in a shoulder pathology. Okay, and why is it so painful?
Sir, because of the secondary impingement? Because of the
calcification. You have impingement, they're not painful, they don't come to tears.
Okay.
So to go back to the pathology, what was the pathology here? Calcific tendonitis.
Yeah.
So the pH of calcium is?
Sorry?
What is the pH of calcium?
I don't know, sir.
The pH of this calcium in the shoulder is about 4, which is acidic. And if you put acid into any joint, that will be really, really painful, isn't it? So this is painful purely because the pH is very low of the structure and it is really, really, really painful. I mean, you cannot imagine it is really painful. So how do you manage these?
Sir, initially I will counsel the patient because it is a prolonged condition. I would advise initially physiotherapy. Ultrasound.
You know, if he has gone and go to another consultant because he's not happy with counseling and physiotherapy. They're painful. I'm telling you, they're in tears. You can't tell them go to physio.
Sir, I would like to do the ultrasound guided.
You can see the calcium.
The ultrasound guided.
You would like to do what? Sorry.
Sir, what do you say? As a needle excision or needle ablation, I forgot to.
Okay. So the easiest thing to do is to numb this area. Is it said? How are you gonna numb this area?
Sir, by subacromial injection with the lidocaine.
You give a local anesthetic. You will give Marcaine, which will last for 4 to 6 hours.
Okay, Marcaine.
So magic pain relief. The pain will go away and it will be far better. So once the pain goes away, the shoulder moves a bit better. Okay? And if the shoulders are going to move a bit better, then the calcium is going to dissipate and it's going to get absorbed and it will clear up. However, you may have to do something more. So if the pain doesn't settle down or comes back after you reject them, what is your next plan?
Sir, ultrasound, sir, guided needle excision of the calcium or reabsorption calcium.
Ask your ultrasound colleague or radiology colleague to do an ultrasound guided needling of this particular procedure, yeah? It will clean it up, but it will not completely go away. So what's the third stage you're going to do then?
Arthroscopic removal of the calcification.
Depending on your experience, you can either open this and clean and debride it, or you can arthroscopically tidy it up.
Right, sir.
Okay, so now if somebody shows you this in the exam, your answer is, this is a shoulder of a skeletally mature person showing calcified tendonitis. So when the examiner says, how do they present? They say they are extremely painful, and they are something that is a sort of an emergency in an A&E regarding a shoulder, one of the few emergencies besides dislocations. Okay, so what I would do is I would give this patient local anesthetic and ask my radiology clinic to see if we can do ultrasound needling. I will eventually list this patient for an arthroscopic or an open decompression to take the calcific tendonitis or the calcium out of the tendon. Okay?
Right, sir.
So this is the plan of management. Do you understand? It's not difficult. You just need to understand what you're looking for and how you can sort it out. So this is when I do the exams for the FRCS orthopedics here, this is one of the x-rays I take with me. And you'll be surprised how many people don't know what it is and how many people don't know how to manage it. And that means that they've never seen one. But this is the most commonest emergency in shoulders you will see in A&E. Okay, well done. So who wants to go next? Who's going next? Everybody's gone quiet now. There's 14 of you here, so somebody has to go. Come on, guys, it is for your own good. I wake up early in the morning to come and talk to you guys. The least you can do is participate.
Second, again.
Does anybody else want to go? I know you want to go, but it is for everybody's benefit, you know. Nobody wants, okay, you can go again then. Have a look.
So first of all, I will start from the x-rays on the screen, on the right side, on the left side.
It's the same patient. This is pre and post reduction, yeah?
Okay. So from the this is the X-ray of the skeletally mature patient of the right shoulder, AP view in which the right shoulder is dislocated inferiorly in the AP view, and on the right side after the reduction, it is the glenohumeral joint is at normal position.
Okay, so this is a 20-year-old. So what would you like to know about this 20-year-old, and if this is a dislocated shoulder?
Sir, I will go in emergency. I will go through the brief. Regarding the history of trauma, either any history of seizure activity.
This patient has any shoulder dislocation every time he moves and twists in bed.
Or, sir, any ligamentous laxity or previous dislocation?
So he has previous dislocations. And I mean, how are you going to assess ligamentous instability then?
Sir, I will assess by checking the there is a Beaton score.
What's a Beaton score?
If it is more than 7, then it is the hyperligamentous laxity. And also on history, there is a ligamentous.
Now that you said beat is interesting, see, the exam is like a radar. The surgeon is sleeping and you are low flying and suddenly you use the word beaten. Okay, so now you've woken me up, so you have to tell me what's Beaton's criteria then.
So Beaton's criteria in which we have to assess the, if the first of all, we will check the wrist, hyperextension of the both elbows. Patient is can easily lean forward and touch his fingers on the ground.
It's bilateral. So if you can
bilateral
fingers parallel to your wrist in extension, that's one. Yes. If you do it on the other side, that's two.
Two. Okay. Similarly, on the elbow, if it is on the one side, is three, and another side is four, and there is a hyperextension of the bilateral knee on the both side.
And touching the floor without bending your knees. 9 altogether, yeah?
Yeah, yes, sir.
So this is hyperlaxity, okay? So how would you, if somebody has not dislocated, on clinical examination, how can you say that this gentleman is hyperlax or this gentleman is unstable with laxity from trauma? Is there any way of assessing that? Say if somebody's on stage, you know, has dislocated his shoulder and you've reduced it and he comes back to the clinic, how can you know this was multiple directional instability or this person has had trauma or some injury which has caused him to be lax?
By clinical examination?
Yes. How?
So I think there is a clinical exam, apprehension test. There is an apprehension test.
So it is apprehension test. Sorry, yeah, it's apprehension test. But what way? It will be positive, isn't it? Whether you're lax.
First of all, we will ask the patient to do if he can. He can dislocate his shoulder and then relocate.
You can't ask somebody to dislocate their shoulder. It's an emergency. You have to reduce it, isn't it? So what you do is you put a sulcus sign. You know what a sulcus sign is?
Yes, sir.
You do traction in longitudinal traction in adduction, and there will be space under the subacromial space. That's called a sulcus sign. In multi-directional instability, if you externally rotate it, it will disappear. But in a laxity from labrum injury or where you're there, it will not disappear. Okay, so that's the difference between a traumatic one and a multi-directional one. That's how you just differentiate them. Okay, but history is a big thing. Okay, so this is now a 20-year-old. You've seen him. You've reduced him. What next?
I will assess for the neurological deficit.
Okay, so there's no neurology. He's come to you 4 weeks. So he's come to you 4 weeks after you've seen him in the A&E. You've reduced him. He's come for a follow-up. His shoulder didn't socket. There is no neurology. He's totally normal. What are you going to do next?
Then I will go for the MRI scan.
Which one?
MRI scan.
Arthrogram. The MRI scan will not show you volume. The MRI scan will not show you a slap lesion. But an MR arthrogram will show you volume of the shoulder. It will also show you slap besides the labral tear. So you will do what is called an MR arthrogram. Okay? You've done the MR arthrogram, and the MR arthrogram has shown you that the labrum has been pulled off. He's got a massive leak into the shoulder. What are you going to do next? How are you going to plan this?
I will go for the...
I'm trying to give you a hint here.
So can you repeat it again?
So this is a 20-year-old adult, okay? And he has now got recurrent dislocation. You have reduced his dislocation. He is now stable. He's come to you, done an MR arthrogram, and the MR arthrogram has shown you that he's got a labrum that's been pulled off, okay? So do you know any concept of instability? Do you know how you classify instability in shoulders?
So there is a one is a multidirectional instability.
Okay.
Traumatic multidirectional instability, and one is traumatic instability.
So there's a word that people use called Tubbs and Embry. Do you know that word?
Yes, sir.
So traumatic is there's always a bank card and you need surgery. Okay.
Yes, sir.
Multidirectional is Embry, which is atraumatic, multidirectional, bilateral. Okay, so we're not going to that classification. We have now decided that this is a young one, and this is a traumatic injury, and we have to manage this. So how are you going to surgically manage this? What plan do you have for this person?
I will see if there is any bank card lesion or not.
MR arthrogram has shown you he's got a bank card lesion.
I will go and I will see either the size of the bank card lesion. What is the size of the bank card?
So what difference does that make? So I have an arthroscopically put 5 anchors in a bank card lesion. So size does not make difference. There's something else that makes a difference. Do you know what's a bipolar lesion, and do you know what's an on track and off track lesion?
Sir, I have a little knowledge about that.
Go on then.
On track lesion is that anterior bony bank card, and once the shoulder dislocated and there is an anterior bank card lesion, then it is a bipolar lesion.
No. So a bipolar lesion means by definition that something's wrong with the humerus and the glenoid.
Okay, sir.
So if you have a Hill sac lesion which is more than 25%, or you have a glenoid which is more than 25% missing, then it becomes a bipolar lesion. Is it a bipolar lesion or not? So you cannot do a soft tissue repair on its own in the labrum. You have to do either front and back repair, put the humerus back arthroscopically, or do a bony repair, which is called a latissimus procedure.
Okay, sir.
okay, and a on track off track lesion is when you are in abduction and external rotation, the shoulder, the humeral head, should be more than seven. I think it's 82% or 78% in the socket, right? If it's less than that, then it's an off track lesion. If you've got a labral injury but it's still in the socket at that position, then it's an on track lesion. So on an on track lesion, you can repair them soft tissue wise. In an off track lesion, you have to do bony bankart. Okay, so this is called an engaging lesion or a bipolar lesion. Okay, lesion, and you have a glenoid which is not normal. This is called a pear-shaped glenoid. So you have a bipolar lesion here. So if you do a Bankart repair, it will not work because it will keep coming out and locking itself. So you have to either do what is called a remplissage, where you stick anchors into the humerus and back, or you do a bony Bankart. You put a latigé here. Okay, so that's a bipolar lesion. Okay, this is an on-track, off-track lesion. Okay, so it's in abduction and external rotation. If the humerus is 84% in contact with the glenoid, then it's an on-track lesion. If it is less than 84% in contact, then it's an off-track lesion. And that's an abduction and external rotation, okay? These are new concepts in shoulders. You must know them because if you have an examiner such as Sufyan and Kazim and all these guys like Omusto, Kamran, Buttonall, they will ask you this question. If you're doing an exam in Karachi and Lahore, they will ask you these questions. Okay, so you need to go and read on-track, off-track lesion and a bipolar lesion, okay? So the glenoid and humeral head should be 83% or more in contact with it in abduction external rotation. That's an on-track lesion. But you have to be bipolar before you can have on-track and off-track again, okay?
Okay, sir.
And this is what you understand by this now. So if you are in abduction external rotation, if you measure the humerus and the glenoid, 83% should be in contact. Okay, and okay, this sir. Humerus head is in contact with the glenoid, even though it's got a defect, then it's an on-track lesion.
Sorry, sir, I can interrupt you over here. Sir, yeah. before seeing the on-track and off-track lesion, we have to check the bipolar lesion.
You have to make sure that there is glenoid missing and there is a Hillside lesion.
Okay.
So it has to be bipolar before you can decide whether it's an on-track or an off-track lesion. Okay?
Okay, sir. Okay, sir.
Because why? Why do we want to know this?
Sir, the management is totally changed if there is a bipolar.
So if you just do a labral attachment in the off-track lesion, it's not going to work.
Okay, sir.
If you do a labral repair in this lesion, so you have to decide whether you want to do a labral attachment or you want to do a latigé. And for that to know, you have to know whether it's a bipolar lesion and whether it's an on-track and off-track lesion, okay? So this you need to understand. If you understand this, the whole management is clear, okay?
Okay, sir.
If you have a glenoid defect, which is less than 25%, and it's an on-track lesion, you will do an arthroscopic Bankart repair or an open Bankart repair, okay? So a glenoid defect less than 25%, and even though you have a Hillside, it is on-track, i.e. 83% or more is in contact with the glenoid when you're in abduction external rotation. Sorry? So in the group two guys, when you have a glenoid defect greater than 25%, but you have an off-track lesion, you can do what is called a arthroscopic Bankart repair and remplissage. So my experience with remplissage is it doesn't work in my hands. So I haven't got a group two management plan, but a lot of experienced surgeons will do remplissage. Okay, I mean, I've done them a few times, but it doesn't work in my hands. So I don't think so. Remplissage works in my hands. So then everything else is latissimo. So you have guys who are less than 25% glenoid defects and they are on track. You will do a soft tissue repair. Everything else, I do a latissimo for them. Do you know what a latissimo is?
Yes, sir.
Anybody, what's a latissimo?
Sir, we manage the anterior inferior glenoid loss by transposing the coronoid.
Yeah, coracoid with its soft tissue attachments. You know, the common joint tendon is left intact. Okay?
Yes.
Okay. So,
there are
two types. So there are two types of latiges. One is called a congruent latige and one is called a non-congruent latige. Okay? So this is under surface of the coracoid, right? And there is the coraco acromial ligament attached. So what the French do is they take this, put this, and you know the undersurface is attached to the glenoid defect. And they use the soft tissue, the coracoacromial ligament, to augment the labrum. So this is called a non-congruent glenoid, because when you look at laterally, there's a step in it. Okay, but original latigé was described like that. And Jilly Walsh from Lyon is now working there, and he is doing still non-congruent up. The Americans and the South Africans, and what we do in England also, is called the congruent arc, where the undersurface of the coracoid matches the anatomy of the glenoid. If you put the undersurface parallel, so I don't know how to get rid of this. Just give me a second. No. Yeah, you can see it in this picture. So if you do a congruent latigé, the curve of the undersurface of the coracoid matches the curve of the glenoid. Okay? So it makes the space extra and congruent, so allow it for the shoulder not to engage and dislocate. Whereas the old latigé, which a lot of people do, is putting the undersurface flat on the coracoid, and they have a step in it, and they end up with long-term complications. Okay, so that's your deciding, and I'll just show you how I do it. I open the under third of the subscap, and then I open the capsule. This is my coracoid. I free it, take the coracoid, and put it in. And you can see the articular surface manages it, and I put a couple of screws into it. And you must see that this is the conjoined tendon with it, and that's important because when we were examining them, we were said that an off-track lesion in abduction external rotation allows them to engage. So with this in abduction and external rotation, it allows it to be a sling, so it stops it going to that position, therefore it is in contact and therefore works. So the concept is you do the coracoid transfers, but you keep the conjoined tendon with it to have a sling effect where it stops it from dislocation. Okay. I know I'm challenging you guys today by telling you some really, really difficult things, but this is basic of the shoulder. If you want to talk about instability or cuff repair, you have to know these things. You cannot talk or see a patient with instability and cuff repair and not know these things. Okay? Are you guys with me, or are you all gone?
No, yes, sir.
Should we stop or should we go again?
Continue.
Sir, can you little bit explain brief about remplissage?
Again, about
remplissage.
Okay.
Or Hill's egg lesion.
So remplissage is basically an arthroscopic procedure. It's not an open procedure. It's an arthroscopic procedure, and you can find the defect, i.e., from posterior portal, you look at where the Hill sac is. Once you found the Hill sac, then you put two anchors in the defect.
Okay.
And then you pull your camera out. And you tie the sutures so that the infraspinatus then goes into the defect.
Okay,
so the infraspinatus, although attached somewhere else, is now also attached to the defect by you putting some sutures into it to bring it down. By doing that, it stops it from falling off the shoulder in the front because of the defect in the bone and the humeral head. So you're actually like putting a pulley on it to stop it from falling off in the front.
Okay, sir.
But I don't think, well, in my experience, I think the soft tissue stretches and it doesn't work for long, and after about a year or so, it starts engaging again. So I have done quite a lot of these remplissage procedures, but in my hands, it doesn't work, like I said. So I do either soft tissue Bancroft repair or do latigés. I don't have patients anymore where I do front and back at the same time.
Okay. Sir, in a remplissage, do we perform a the glenoid redirection?
Sorry, I didn't hear. I can't understand your questions.
Sir, in remplissage, do we perform glenoid redirection osteotomy?
You have to do both. You have to do the back cut in the front and remplissage in the back. You do them both together. So you put your anchors in the front, right? But you don't tighten them, because if you tighten them, it'll push the humerus at the back and you won't be able to do the remplissage. So you put the anchors of the Bancroft in the front, and then you go back, put your anchors into the defect, then tie those anchors at the back, and then come back to the front and tie the front anchors. It is a complicated procedure. Like I said, I mean, I've been doing shoulders for 17 years, but in my hands it doesn't work, so I've given it up. I've stopped doing them since 2010.
Okay, sir.
Sir, there is a question. In regarding, sir, the on-track and off-track, sir, congruity, Do we what special? Do we do special views, or do we just see the plain CT graph in the sagittal? Or
it is done by special views and CT scans. First of all, is you have to diagnose this patient has a bipolar lesion. So to diagnose bipolar lesion, you have to have a CT scan or you have to have an MR sonogram. So I do CT scans, and the CT scan will show me it's got a bipolar injury, i.e. the glenoid is missing, less than 25% is missing, or more than 25% missing. And there's a Hill-Sachs lesion which is engaging or non-engaging. Once that's done, my radiologist automatically will then take CT scans in abduction and external rotation. Okay, so you have to have your shoulder and abduction external rotation to do the on-track, off-track lesion.
Thank you, sir.
So I'll make it simple for you. You know, you mean you can tell the examiner that's engaging or non-engaging, but you can tell the examiner that there are two ways of managing them. You do a soft tissue management or you do a bony management. If it's a bipolar lesion and the glenoid is less than 25%, or the Hill-Sachs is engaging, I will do a lateral procedure. If it is not, and it's only a soft tissue procedure, I'll do a Bankart repair. That's the easiest way to describe this. Okay?
Okay.
Okay, sir.
So do you want to go one more, or should we call it and we'll come back again? I mean, there's plenty of time. We can do loads of shoulders and loads of other things in the next week.
I think we should take a 10-minute break.
So who's going to volunteer? I mean, there's 10 minutes. Nobody has to talk. Make sure that your telephone is locked in the background. We don't want to other sounds coming to it. Okay, so this is the last one. So tell me what this is. And who's going?
Sir, may I?
You can't. I mean, people need to understand that they have to participate to learn. You can't not participate and do exams because there's guaranteed. So I know you want to try, but somebody else wants to have a go. You've already had a go, isn't it?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, so somebody else. I don't like passive learners, because at the exam, you will be passive and dominant and you won't be able to answer any questions at all. Nobody wants to have a go. Yeah, well, guys, you know, I'm spending a lot of time here with you guys, and if you don't want to participate, then I don't have to come on a Sunday morning. For me, I can go and have a nice nashta. Have, you know, on Sundays we have halwa puri and chola in our town. So I can go and do that. I mean, I don't have to do this, but you have to participate for me to be interested in this. If nobody wants to participate, then for me it's a waste of time. I mean, this is the most easiest preparation you're going to have. I don't insult, I don't shout, I don't scream, I don't humiliate. And I think I know a bit about what I'm talking about, so I give you information that is going to be good for you, not silly book readings. But you have to talk. In the exam, if you don't talk, you will not pass. So nobody wants to have a go.
Oh, sorry, again.
Okay, go on then. This is the final one, you do it. But next time, I'm not going to do this if nobody wants to play.
This is the X-ray of the skeletally mature patient of the right shoulder, in which there is a disruption of the acromioclavicular joint with the superior migration of the distal end of the clavicular.
So why do you have to say all that? Why can't you just say this is an X-ray of a mature skeletally mature person which shows disruption of the AC joint and leave it at that? Okay. So then the examiner will ask you. So what grade is this?
According to the sir, on the radiographic examination, there is a classification. There is a Rockwood classification of this.
Absolutely correct. It's a Rockwood classification. Okay. So
yes, sir.
Do you know what this is,
sir? In which both sir, it is I think type 3.
So it's either a 4, 5, or a 6. Okay?
There are 6 types. There are 6 types.
Yeah, so there are 6 types. This is either a 4, 5, or a 6. Because it's 100% displaced.
Yes, sir. It is a superior displacement.
Yes.
So,
last X-ray, you don't know whether super. Yes, you can see it on this one. But on this X-ray, you only have it's either a 4, 5, or a 6. Okay? So 5 is superior displacement, 4 is in front, and 6 is in the back. Yeah?
Yes, sir.
Six
is inferior, 5 is superior, and 4 is posterior, I think.
Yes.
Okay. So I've not read it lately, but yeah, you're right. There's 4, 5, and 6 is So how do you know clinically that this is a 4, 5, or 6? Clinically,
on clinical examination, there is a tinting of the skin, and on inspection.
No, it isn't. Yeah. You will see the prominence of the clavicle, right?
Okay.
And if you push the elbow up, even in acute trauma, straight after, it will reduce in a type 5.
Okay, sir. Type 5.
If it doesn't reduce, it is stuck into soft tissue, i.e. it is either a 4 or a 6.
Okay, sir.
So 4, 5, and 6 are surgical indications.
Yes.
Okay. 4 and 6 is an emergency, and 5 is within 4 weeks of injury.
So can you again explain
the elbow, okay?
Leave the
elbow is putting the scapula down, but the weight of the shoulder is putting the scapula down, so the clavicle stays where it should be, but the shoulder blade moves down. So if you push the elbow up, it will reduce the injury. So if it does, it's a 5.
Okay, sir.
If it doesn't reduce, it's a 4 or a 6.
Okay, sir.
So 4 and 6 is an emergency. And 5, you have to do surgically within the first 4 weeks.
Okay, sir.
Okay, the 1, 2, and 3, you can observe, and 99% of them will heal and would not need a surgical option.
Okay, sir.
Okay, so if you were going to repair this, how would you repair this? This is a classification, actually. So a type 4 type 4 is going at the back, and a type 6 is going in the front. You're right, okay? So this is the classification. This is the Rockwood classification, okay? And how would you repair this? How would you
repair this? There is a multiple technique. First is the Karako clavicular fixation, screw fixation, open reduction and internal fixation of the Karako clavicular screw. This is the Bosworth screw. And another is the Karako clavicular fixation with the suture fixation, which is a Dunn-Weaver technique.
And what would you do? So you will tell them what you want to do. Yes, I know there are various fixations. You can do a non-anastomical and anastomical fixation. The non-anastomical is a Weaver-Dunn procedure where you take the correct acromial ligaments and stick into it, okay? The anastomical one is the Bosworth procedure, the hook plate, or reconstruction or repair of these with an augmentation. Yes?
So I usually in my residency, I did 2 or 3 hook plates.
Okay. So if you're doing a hook plate or a Bosworth screw, what is the one thing you have to tell the patient when you're operating them?
Sir, before the surgery, we have to counsel the patient that we have to remove this plate after 6 weeks or 8 weeks. Once the healing is, once the this joint is reduced and healing done by the fibrosis, then we have to remove. Secondly, there is a chance. Plate exposure due to the very superficial. The plate is placed very superficially, so there is a chance of exposure.
So that's good. But listen now, okay? So if you are doing any kind of repair, not reconstruction, it has to be done in the first 4 weeks, because the ligaments will heal if they're in 4 weeks. If they're more than 4 weeks, they will not heal. So if you're going to do a Bosworth screw or a hook plate, you have to do them in the first 4 weeks. Okay? Because what you're doing is putting the AC joint back so that the conoid and trapezoid ligament can heal.
Yes, sir.
Agreed?
Yes, sir.
But you have to take the Bosworth screw and the hook plate out once the ligaments heal. The ligaments heal within 6 weeks of surgery. Their injury is less than 4 weeks, then they will heal within 6 weeks of surgery. If the injury is more than 4 weeks, it will never heal. So the reason you take the Bosworth screw or the hook plate out is for shoulder to move. Every 3 degrees of elevation, you have 1 degree of rotation in the clavicle.
Okay.
Yes, so if you don't take the hook plate out or you don't take the Bosworth screw out, the patient will only achieve maximum of 100 degrees of abduction, because he will lose the 1/3 elevation because the clavicle is not helping.
Okay, sir.
So the reason you move these out is to get full function, because the clavicle is not rotating, therefore they don't have function in the last, 1/3 function is lost.
Sir, multiple times the question came in a form of an exam, in a previous exam. There is a specific, they ask a very specific question that a patient having an AC joint disruption, and the patient is the laborer. So what is the best way of management?
Okay.
Multiple times this question came in our past. MCQs.
Okay, so the best way of managing this is depends on whether it's before 4 weeks or after 4 weeks. Okay, so before 4 weeks, you can put a buzzword screw or a hook plate and it will go back to work straight away.
Okay, sir.
But if it is after 4 weeks, then you have to augment it and reconstruct the ligament. So you have to put a graft in. And if you do grafts in there, they can never go back to work straight away. There will be 6 weeks before they can go back to work. So in a laborer, the best management is either a buzzword screw or a hook plate, provided it is done within the first 4 weeks.
Okay, sir.
Okay, so what construction methods do you know?
Sir, there are two in which we can, the ligament reconstruction we use for, we take two grafts. One is a palmaris longus graft and another is a semitendinous graft.
So palmaris longus is not strong enough to hold your clavicle. So you will have to do the hamstring grafts, yeah? And you take the hamstring graft and you put it around the clavicle and hook it around the coracoid. So you do an open reduction to reduce it. Okay, it is definitely done after 4 weeks.
Yes, sir. I haven't seen a single case in my whole residency because the patient never came late or no one.
Which is surprising because in Pakistan, everybody comes 6 months or 3 months down the line. Yeah, you know, most of them are coming very late.
But no one is having expertise in doing this tendon graft.
Yeah, but it's a simple hamstring procedure. You take it out and put a sling across it anyway. So, what we do is what we just discussed. So if it's less than 4 weeks, the ligaments will heal. Okay?
Yes, sir.
For the ligaments to heal, all you have to do is put the clavicle back, it should be. So you put a screw in, which is a buzzword screw, you put a hook plate in. Okay? And if it comes late, then you can do a non-anatomical procedure, which is called a Viva Dung. You take the coracoacromial ligament and stick it to the end of the clavicle. Yes?
Okay.
But that's a non-anatomical procedure. Okay? Or what we do in my practice is that if you come in early, i.e. less than 4 weeks in time, and you have a type four, so I would do what is called a tightrope, which is a suture with a button on it, and I do it keyhole.
Okay, sir. I also see this procedure.
Sorry?
I also saw this procedure.
Yeah, so, or if it comes in more than 4 weeks down the line, then I would do what is called this. It's an artificial graft. It's a last ligament. And it's called Sergileg, and we put the clavicle down and hook the acromion. But this is only after 4 weeks. You can't do it, but you can do it early. But the best thing is when the ligaments are not healing, then you do substitute the ligaments. So this is called a Sergileg.
Okay, sir.
Okay. So we call it a day. I'm going to have a cup of tea, yeah?
Thank you so much.
But you must tell your colleagues, you know, that if you don't participate, you cannot pass exam. You have to learn to talk.
Yes, sir. You are absolutely right, because after reading, we can't recall after a few days back. Once the thing I read, I forgot, because the memory is recalled only those things which we can read it again, or we can try to teach and talk with somebody.
But the other thing is that if you don't say it to the examiner thinks you don't know, isn't it?
So you are right.
And you know, when in a computer, there's a desktop. And if you save something on a desktop, it takes an instant to bring it back. But if you save it somewhere else, you have to look for it. So if you practice answering questions, if somebody asks you, how are you going to do a cuff repair? You would now have discussed and spoken to it to me. So you'd be a lot easier to recall and then discuss this with the examiner. However, if you start reading, you've read everything, you've understood everything, but you don't understand what to say. For example, all of you must have read cuff repairs, but none of you knew the concept of repairable or irreparable cuffs, isn't it?
Yes, sir.
Unless you discuss, you want to, and then you need to know that if you're repairing a cuff, it's like any other tendon in the body. You have to have a double row repair. You have to have a core suture and a running suture, which is normal for every tendon you repair in the body. You need to know that supraspinatus is the key structure in putting the shoulder to make it function. You also need to know that what are the options if you can't repair in a young person and an older person. All these things you have read, but unless you discuss it, you will not remember it for the exam. That's why I spend the whole Sunday morning with you guys so that you can repair. I mean, you can do the exams. I remember talking, if you talk to the guys we did last year, they will tell you a lot of them passed the exams only because they were discussing.
Yes, sir. You are absolutely okay. Right.
So we'll call it a day. I always have a video saved of what we do, so I will post it on the forum. And hopefully next Sunday we'll meet again then. All right.
Thank you, sir.
Inshallah.
But all of you must participate, not just do my waiting for me to do, isn't it? Yeah.
Sir, inshallah, would be the first. But we also have the bad habit of, as you said, confabulation, saying unnecessary things.
Yes, you need to be.